the community family. And the third gang, which is the larger one, they call it Brotherhood of Nationality. If you are somebody from the same country, you are a brother. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah An-Nisa, verse 4, فَإِنْ كَانَ لَهُ أُخْوَةٌ فَلِأُمِّهِ السُّدُسُ. The ayat of distributing heritage. When somebody packs the properties and belongings that he leave behind, the distribution of that, the Almighty Allah Himself took care of that. He never lived that with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And this distribution can be among brothers and all across relatives to show how important it is. He also said in Surah Yusuf, Surah number 22, verse 59, قَالْ إِتُونِي بِأَخِنْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَبِيكُمْ. He said, this is the statement of Yusuf alayhi salam. When his brother then went to him, after all the journey, the whole story, after he became king, or part of the kingdom of the king in Egypt, when they went to him, they didn't recognize him, that he was their brother, Yusuf, who they threw in the well, who they desired to kill, all of that, Allah saved him from all of that, and now he was in power. He told them, when you go back, come with your brother. He was referring to his brother, Benjamin, a brother from one man and one pa. قَالْ إِتُونِي بِأَخِنْ لَكُمْ. Bring me your brother. And he was very generous to them. He said, so bring me your brother. This ayat and many more, it just show us brotherhood in Islam. And the most important brotherhood is the brotherhood of the religion. It's the best and it's the strongest. You and somebody might be from one man, one pa, but if he's not Muslim, actually, he's not your brother. You might have a son. If he's not Muslim, he's not your son in the sight of Allah. We all know the story of Nuh alayhi salam. When his son refused to come on the boat with them or the ark, and after the destruction or when the water was coming, he turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking him to forgive his son. He said, Innahu ibni wa innahu anak al-haq, that he is my son, and you promise. The promise he referred to here, the children of the Anbiya, we will assume that they will be on the path of their parents. But Allah told him, that is not the case. إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ إِبْنِكَ إِنَّهُ أَمَلُ غَيْرُ صَالِحِ إِنِّي أُعِذُكَ أَنْ تَكُونَ مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ. He is not your son. He's your son, but he's not your biological son. He's not your son. He's not your son when it comes to religion. I'm counseling you, I'm admonishing you for you to be among the poor of Jahiliyyah. And Jahil, when you hear Jahil in the Quran, it got two meanings. Jahil, ignorant, somebody who doesn't know anything. And Jahil, the second meaning, thing that you do, you might be very knowledgeable, you memorize the Quran, you memorize the Hadith, you know the Ta'lim of Islam, but you do things that is contradictory to the teaching of Allah and the teaching of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So they will call you Jahil. So in this case, Allah is telling Prophet Nuh, what you are seeing, what you are requesting from me, it is not compatible with the manhaj of Allah, the teaching of Allah, asking me to forgive your son when he has refused to come with you. So that brotherhood, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam demonstrated it in Medina after Hijrah. He made brotherhood relationship between the Ansar and the Muhajirun. He made them brother. He created it, in other words. It was his creation. And it was not less service. It was a serious business. To the point that some of the Ansar, who have multiple wives, gave all their wives for their brother that came from Mecca. And not only that, they showed them all their wives. Some of them showed their wives to their brother, the people that brother who were between them. He said, "These are my wives. Choose whomever you admire, you want, I will put in divorce and you can marry her." It's not like, okay, you can marry that woman. Maybe perhaps that's a woman he does not like. It was not like that. They gave their choice. But they say, "Jazakallah, may Allah bless you and reward you." Another one, they share their wealth, their property, their businesses. Like Abdurrahman bin Auf, he told his brother, he said, "Just show me the way to the market. Thank you very much, but show me the way to the market." And he showed him the way to the market, and Abdurrahman bin Auf began one of the richest companions in Medina. This brotherhood, we talked about it before, and I'm reminding myself and all of us that this deen, you know, this is one of the core values in our religion. To love people because of Allah. To love people because of the deen. Not because you're from the same village, same country, but you love them because of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the authentic hadith reported by Bukhari and Muslim, on the authority of Anas ibn Malik, radiyallahu anhu, قال, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. That none of you will be a true believer until he love for his brother what he love for himself. You must love for your brother what you love for yourself before you can be a true believer. May Allah make us among the believers. The second khutbah I want to remind all of us about is the khutbah, the story of the three men from Bani Israel, from the story of the children of Israel. And we say Bani Israel, they are the children of Yaqub alayhi salam, Prophet Yaqub, his descendant. They are called Bani Israel. And we find a lot of that in the Quran, hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this story is very applicable to our life today. And the story is that three people from Bani Israel. One was Abras, the other one was Akra, and the third one was A'ma. One was Abras, the first one had leprosy. You all know leprosy, right? He had leprosy on him. His feet, his hands, fingers were all off. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an angel to test them, these three people. The man with the leprosy, and the blind man, and the bald head man. To test them, try it. And we said before that the angel changed in different form. They come in the form of human beings. They come in their real form as angel. Prophet Jibril alayhi salam, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his real form 2 times. First, when he came with the Quran, Surah Al-Iqra, to the Prophet, that was the first time. And the second time, when he took the prophet in the Isra wal Miraj, as the hadith said. He also came to him in the form of men. One of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by the name of Tahiyyatul Kalbi, he was known for that. He was very handsome, bright. So Jibril used to come in his form all the time to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and deliver the message. So here, the point I'm trying to make, here the angel came in the form of men to these three people. The first person with a leprosy came to him complaining that he is poor, he's suffering, he's traveling. You know, he came to him asking him what he needs. He told the angel that what I need is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure me. Cure my leprosy, make me healthy. Because people hate me because of this. They don't want to see me in their midst. They don't want to see me around them. The angel wiped his hair on him like this, went down, and the leprosy went away. Again, he went to the second man. I don't know the period between that. The hadith never talk about that. But he went to the second man with a bald head. Today, maybe we might like bald head. People, they love bald head. But some people don't do. So he had a bald head. He asked him, what do you want? Let me go back a little bit. Well, the leprosy man, well, after he killed him, he asked him, what kind of wealth he need? Money. He told him, he said, Ibil Ashura. I mean, Ibil that can born. Camel that can born. So he gave him that. Now, the second man with a boy here, he asked him what he need. He told him to kill me out of this sickness. A sickness that people, I mean, hate me, they detest me, they stay away from me. That's what I want. He killed him, same thing. He rubbed on him like this, his sickness went away, and he asked him, what do you want? What kind of wealth do you want? Property. He said, I need bakar, a pregnant cow. And he gave him that pregnant cow. He went to the third man and the last man with the blind man. He did the same thing to him. He asked him, what do you like? He said, I want to be able to see people, to go attend my business, move easily. He said, that's what I want. And he made the same thing. That blind went away from him and asked him, what do you want? He told him, Ghana, I need lamb, sheep. He gave him that. So after a while, they see angel man came. The angel came back. He came to the first man first. In his form. He made he came what? He came with the angel came with leprosy. He came with leprosy, all white flesh, all white hand, feet. To that man, see man that he killed. When he came to him, he asked him, he said, oh, I'm a traveler. I need money. You know, I ran out of money. I need money to get to my destination. He told him, Al-Hukubu Kathira, I got so many responsibility, I can't afford that. So he made dua on him. Sayyarakallahu ila makunta alayhi. May Allah take you back in your old condition to begin to be leprosy. And that happened. He went to the second man, the man with the boy here. He asked him again, same thing. I'm traveling. I don't have money. I need help to get to my destination. He told me the same thing, complaining, oh, too many responsibility. I can't afford. He made dua on him. May Allah take you back to your old condition. And he became blind again. And he came to the third man, the blind man. He told him the same thing. I'm traveling, I'm stranded, I need help to get to my destination. And the man told him, everything you see here so is for Allah. I was blind, and Allah cured me. He gave me this wealth. So take whatever you want. Then the angel told the man, Barakallahu fiqh, and Barakallahu fi malik. May Allah bless you and bless your wealth. He said, I'm an angel. Allah sent me to test you, three of you, and name them, and you have passed the test. So, my dear brother and my dear sisters, if you look at this story, the hadith, maybe it might be said like 2,000 or 3,000 years ago, before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But today, we are living situation, most of you might know about it, when people deny the favor of Allah upon them. When people deny that however condition they're in, good job, money, business, work, family, if people deny all of that, that is from Allah, and justifying that it's because they are smart, because they know people, because they have master or PhD, this is what make them to be like that. You are like those three men. And the result of that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take that ni'mah from you. May Allah save all from that.
Amen.
Our third topic is the topic of suspicious. We talked about it before. And we said suspicious is something that a Muslim, you must stay away from it. Because the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِيَّاكُمَ الظَّنِّ فَإِنَّ الظَّنِّ أَكْذَبُ الْحَدِيثِ. That suspicion is, stay away from suspicion, because it is a lie. It is something, if you used to it, you know, you will always lie and lie and lie, because you're gonna be keep judging people. I mean, judging them wrongly. And we say that nobody control the heart but Allah. The heart is in the hand of the Almighty Allah. If you keep suspecting people, you will hardly deal with anybody. You will hardly trust anybody, because you always feel that, you know, you don't know what they're up to, what they're doing, all of that. We're not required to do that. Is he a Muslim? He's not a Muslim. He's this. The only thing yesterday we have, if you see somebody making salah, coming to the masjid, fasting Ramadan, give me a zakah, his sadaqah, going to Hajj, that's the yardstick we have. Umar ibn Khattab, he used to tell the companion, he said, لَكَدْ إِنْقَطَعَ الْوَحْيِ. The revelation has stopped. The Prophet is dead. He said, when the Prophet was living, Allah made sure that he put everybody in his proper position when he make mistake. Allah is not somebody to lead that going, or the Prophet himself. He always correct it. You are this, you are that, you are this. He said, but after the revelation has stopped, all we have now is people deeds that we see. So he told the companion, Aruni Salih Amalikum, show me your good deed, show me your best side. He said, I will use that to give you responsibility. That's how we're supposed to be as Muslims, in order to keep our brotherhood intact. And if you see your brother, now, if you want to advise him, perfect. That's the best way. Call him on the side. That's a true brotherhood. Call you on the side, my dear brother. I see you doing this. Give me some room to explain myself. I see you doing this. I see you going over there. Or I heard that you do this confidentially. Maybe you have a reason. Maybe something happens. It might not be true. But don't build that, you know, keep building it, keep building it, keep building it. All you're building is a sin on yourself. Right there, you're making dawah by advising him, because the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ad-deenu nasiha, that religion is advice. So you advise him. If he's wrong, you tell him. This is not the way you do it, brother. You have to stop this. Oh, my sister, you have to stop this. Between you and the person. Then that's an advice, good way of advising. But if you go outside and say it publicly, or put it on Facebook, say it any other public way, the scholar called that disgracing him. You're disgracing the person. And for the most part, nobody will accept that. They will even be on the offensive because you try to disgrace them. They will defend themselves, even if they are wrong. But if your purpose is dawah to change the person, that is the best way to do it, to call him and talk to him secretly. We'll also talk about trustworthiness. And this is something we say everybody experiencing it every day, to trust one another. And the Quran talk about it. Allah said, "Inna aradna al-amanata ala samawati wal-ard fa'abayna ayahmilnaha wa hamala al-insan innahu kana zaluma jahula." That we indeed presented the trust to the heaven and the earth. But they refused to take it because of the huge responsibility it comes with. And human being accepted it out of ignorance. We didn't know what it means. We took it. And we are failing to carry on that responsibility. And we say amana include ibadat, the worship we do for Allah, doing it on time, doing it accurately, doing it according to the Quran and Sunnah is amanah. Monitoring things, property things between you and people, giving things to people back when they give it to you. Even some scholars say, even rental property, rental car, you can't abuse it because it's not for you. You can't abuse it because it's for company, they got a lot of money. Yeah, if you use it, you return it, you try your best to take care of it and return it back to them as you took it. When you rent in people's property, you make sure you maintain it as it was yours. You see, all of it is amana. And we also talk about our little masjid here. And we remind people what we're doing, our aqidah, our manhaj, our program. And that is going to be part of the second khutbah, inshallah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لكم من كل ذنب إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وصلى وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Maybe most of you here or some of you here, you are managers in company, you are supervisors, or you run your own business, and I think, you know, whatever capacity you're in, you know, you have plan, business plan, business program, business project. Sometimes when it comes to dawah, We take it light. We take it light. It's nothing. It's no strategy. You just go pray and go. You do whatever you want to do. What's that mean? I disagree to that. For the time I begin to know myself, I mean, I've been very careful about this. Whatever I do for Allah, that is clear, is based on plan, is based on strategy. Why? Because that keeps you on the straight path. It keeps your dawah on the straight path. Even if you're not there, people that will come after you, they will say, well, this is how this masjid is being operated. And the people that understand that, they will always make sure that they stand for that. Most of the problem that we have in today as a Muslim is, for the most part, we go for our personal understanding, our personal ego, our desire. And Allah told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you follow their desire, you're gonna be all over the place. You're gonna misguide yourself. You're gonna go astray. So that's why it's so important that we remind ourselves of that. And I'm talking about it again today because all the time, Allah bless our new believer, new stranger, new visitor. Plus, reminding ourselves is just the Quran. So our aqidah here, aqidah means belief, the belief, what we believe in as Muslim. That doesn't mean it's going across the board. But I, as an imam, and I believe my sheikh too, and most of you here, what we stand for. And we're not going to say, okay, don't come here because you don't stand for that. No, we're not like that. Aqidah means tenet. And the tenet in Islam is six things. Al-Iman billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wal yawm al-akhir wal qadr khayrihi wa sharrihi. Believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's a huge topic. But briefly, I just want you to understand those six things. Believe in Allah and believing in the angel of Allah. We talk about the angel of Allah. They are different functions. 2 weeks ago, a brother, you know, he always bring bread for us here. He bring one of the best bread. So I never saw him for maybe a month. And I told him, the angel was asking about you and your bread. He was extreme like this, he's scared. And it's true. I mean, whatever deal you do, even on Friday, the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on Friday, the angel, every angel has some responsibility. On Friday, angel come just for Friday. They will come stand to the door and wait for people to come, writing a reward. And you know the reward? The first person that will come, he will get a reward of camel. The second person will get a reward of baccarat. The third person will get a reward of ganam, sheep. The fourth person will get a reward of chicken. The fifth person will get a reward of egg. After that, he close a book. When the imam enter, he close a book. That's it. Anybody that coming after that, they're not going to get a reward of Juma. So you have to make sure you come in before the imam enter. Do that job. When the video was done, they go back. I don't know whether they come back again the next Juma or that's it. Because there are so many of them. And some are there, they wouldn't go to look for masajid in the land. They go to siyah, like a tourist. That's all they look for. They're not looking for skyscraper, tower, nothing. Masajidullah. That's what they're looking for. So when I told this brother this, he was shocked. But that's the reality. When you're doing good, this $1 you gave, wallahi, you're not going to regret your matiyama. Why I never make it to that? Why I never make it to that? Because it's an angel that's reporting that for you. He gave sadaqah. The angel gives sadaqah. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every day, it's an angel that coming down. Two angels coming down specifically for that. Making dua for those who give Allah, for Allah to multiply them, increase their wealth. And making dua against those who hold him back. Oh Allah, destroy his wife. Make him poor. So, am I right or not? So those who bring bread here, those who bring rags here, I mean food here, Monday and Thursday for the believer, the angels are reporting everything. So going quickly, the third tenet is believing in the book of Allah. The book of Allah includes the Zabur that was sent to Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, include Sophie Musa, include the Torah, the Injil, the Old Testament, and the New Testament. And we said before that you have to believe in those things. We know that it has been manipulated. We know that it has changed a lot of things. But you have to believe that the origin of this book is for Allah. You can say, oh, that's Christian people book. That Jewish people book. It was for Allah. And we have a rule in Islam that Shari'atu man qablana, Shari'atuna. That the teaching of those people that before us, the Sharia they have is our Sharia, unless when the Quran comes and says clearly that we should not follow that, we should not follow this. So they change a lot of things, but there's still some things, I mean, in it that match with the Quran, match with the Hadith. We just mentioned the story of the three people from Bani Israel. So you get condemned like that. Or besides that too, we have to be able to respect other people's religion. You have to respect other people's religion. Now, if you're going to debate, debate with respect. Dialogue is fine. Debate is fine. But if your point is, if you try to make down on the people, to change them to your religion, you have to be based on respect. Not insult your own opinion. Opinion that might be even foolish. Your opinion on politics. Your opinion on society business. Your opinion on anything. You know, it's not easy for somebody to come change you. If you start to err, maybe it's wrong, but the way you approach, you will refuse to change because the way the person approaches you on it. Is that true or not? So, let alone religion, why is so important to everybody. So, when you're making dawah to your Christian friend or Jewish friend, you should keep that in your mind. Try to change them like that with respect. And this is what Allah said. Call them, you know, polite. Call towards the way of your law based on hikmah, wisdom, and good speech. So, the fourth tenet is the iman bi-rusul, believing in the prophets and messenger of Allah. And we say, Allah is saying, 125,000 messengers and prophets from the time of Adam to the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have to believe all of that, including Jesus and Moses, including Isa and Musa kalimullah. You have to believe in all of them. You can't say, oh, he was not sent to me. If you do that, your iman is incomplete. The fifth one is Yawm al-Qiyamah. You have to believe in that. There are people that think this dunya is the end of everything. When they die, it's not going to be behind that. No. We're going to die, and we are going to be resurrected. We're going to be asked for our deed. Everything you did, Allah is going to ask you about it. Your good and your bad. The prophet say, فَمَنْ وَجَدَ خَيْرًا فَلْيَحْمَدِ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ وَجَدَ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ فَلَا يَلُومَنَّ إِلَّا نَفْسَهُ. Allahu Akbar. Whoever died, if you are successful, you should thank Allah. And if you're not, don't blame anybody but yourself. Fala yalumanna illa nafsa. It was yourself. You were told and refused to follow. Now finally, the sixth one, al-iman bi-qadr, to believe in destiny, predestiny, the good and the bad. Why this is so important again? Because some people think Whatever happened today in their life, difficulty, hardship, maybe that's somebody, my neighbor or my friend is witchcrafting me, doing something to me. Or my wife is doing something. We got that a lot. It is my wife. He's trying to, and women do it too, to be honest, so that they can be the women, may stay with the man, not to marry any other man. Women do that a lot. I want to tell you that. If you believe in that, then you do not believe in this sixth tenet. As a Muslim, you focus on God, you worship. I tell you now, any Muslim, wallah, you believe in Allah. You believe in these six things. You pray right. No mighty man who already are will be able to do you anything. But when you are shaking, you're not sure, then you have problem. They will happen. This is the secret. So you have to believe that the good you have is from Allah. The good law you have is from Allah. The bad law you have is from Allah. It doesn't mean people are not going to try to harm you, to hurt you. But if Allah do agree, wallah, it's not going to happen. Whatever happened to you, it may Allah agree to that. You have to know that. And ask him alone to help you. This is the sixth tenet that we believe in. Now, our manhaj is methodology. Methodology is, again, to my managers, supervisor of company, corporation. Methodology in Islam is the way you do your da'wah, the way the technique you use, the method you use. You want to make big profit, you know, you want to have big success, you have your goal, you have your objective. What is the means to get to that? The technique you use to get to that. That's what we call manhaj. And then manhaj is a very serious thing. And I want you to pay attention, brother. If you get a manhaj wrong, well, you're going to get a lot of things wrong. You have to follow the manhaj to the letter according to the Quran and the Sunnah. Then manhaj, who do we get it from? It's from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba and our guide predecessor, rahimahullah. We got it from them. You have to stick to that. Now, let me put it, you know, more clear than that. Some people will believe that the deen of Allah is, to rule people, to be in authority. Sharia, Ra'is, president, to be Muslim. To go after authority is wrong. From the time of Prophet Nuh alayhi salam down to our Prophet, it was never like that. That you have to go after people before you make your da'wah. It was all about da'wah and to worship Allah alone. Not to associate banner unto Allah. That's what Prophet Nuh told his people. Hud told his people, Prophet Musa told Fir'aun. Look at the story of Fir'aun and Musa alayhi salam for Adam. When Allah said it to Fir'aun, they went there to tell him, Inna Rasul Rabbik, that we are the messenger of your Lord. The message was, the purpose was, the mission was, and to receive Ma'ana Bani Israel, but not to Adibun. You should say along with us, the children of Israel, do not oppress them. Do not torture them. That's what their mission. They never talk about, they never told Fir'aun be Muslim. They never even told him that. Who brought about Allah? It's Fir'aun himself. He the one that brought about Allah. I'm not saying Allah is not stand for Allah. But in that mission of Musa alayhi salam and his brother Harun, it was about to free the children of Israel from persecution and torture. He said to them, "Woman, woman, woman, who is your Lord then? The Lord is sending you for me to send the children of Israel with you. Who is he?" That's how the issue of Lord came in the picture. Then they told him, "Our Lord, who created the heaven and the earth." Then that was the debate started from. So if Rana has said, "No people, well, I will enjoy it. He will Lord live long and enjoy his power and authority." But he did not only refuse, he tried to chase Prophet Musa alayhi salam. That was where the Prophet came from. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came to Quraysh, he told them, "This deen, if you accept it, you will rule the Arab and the foreign will be subject to you because it puts you up." He never told them, "Okay, release your authority, give me your power, let me be the leader of Quraysh." There's no way in the Quran or hadith like that. He just told them down. They refused. So that's why, I mean, they not only refuse, they attack him and he has to defend himself. So what I'm saying is this is manhaj. If you don't understand that, you're gonna be in trouble. And like the trouble we're having today all over the place, everybody go with their own understanding, which is creating problems all over. I'm not saying that the Sharia of Allah is not supposed to govern. It's supposed to govern because the land belongs to Allah. But if it's not there, it's not there. You can't force it. You can't impose it. If you have a country 100% Muslim or 90% Muslim, and that's what they want, fine. That's good. Then you go for it. But you cannot force it on people or kill people because of that. Manhaj. The second tools you use in Dawah to reach your goal, as we said before, is brotherhood. Brotherhood. Having good brotherhood. And alhamdulillah, we also have that here. This masjid, we base it on that from day one. And that's why you all see this diversity. You see the diversity that you never see or you hardly see in most masjid. From all background, all culture. And we base this exactly on the manhaj of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah bless all to have that. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of you and to give us the understanding of the deen inshallah and to forgive our sin. Now you know that always every effort is gonna be criticism. It's gonna be, you know, people that don't like what you're doing. And that's human nature and we don't have problem with that. That's why we always open to people that you want to come in. We always have room for people to be part of this, to be part of the da'wah. Inshallah, I keep saying this over and over, that da'wah is not based on people's life. If you do this yourself for Allah, you really want something that would be there forever, even if you're not there. And that can only be done through the commitment of a sincere brother, sincere Muslim. So everybody again is welcome, inshallah. With anything, any idea, we are open to it, inshallah, if it's for the sake of Allah. Ask the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive all of us and forgive our family. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina adhaban nar. Wa adkhilna al-jannata ma'al ulama ya aziz ya ghafur rabbal alamin. Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahmatan innaka antal wahhab. اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك لا اله الا انت سبحانك انا كنا من الظالمين لا اله الا انت سبحانك انا كنا من الظالمين لا اله الا انت سبحانك انا كنا من الظالمين اقم الصلاه ان الصلاه تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله اكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون